in other places, mainly to transmit the message of Dharma, the message of a higher living. And this year, he is traveling with the message of world peace. And during this time, he is able to visit this great land. And the vital forces working in this land, the higher forces working in this land, has accepted, invited, permitted him to come here. And world peace is a common concern. And we are all trying in some way or other for that. Many prayers, many programs are being carried out everywhere. And whenever we do something, we should know for well what is the underlying principle of it. Understanding is most important to us. And what is this sense, what we say the world peace? And could we say that world peace does not exist? And if not existing, why? What is the reason? And what is the solution? And where we have to start? And what is the track? Likewise, we should have the correct understanding and direction and solution. And if we have all this aspect, any act that we do will be fulfilled. The purpose will be accomplished. Let us think about the world peace. And we say that in the nature now many things are happening. Maybe in the future many more things can happen. And human life on earth can be in danger. A complete destruction is possible. We are concerned about all these things. But what is the fact? Can ever nature be in turbulence? And what is the original formation of the nature? And Sri Tathagata would say that the nature is always in peace. And it is in order because it cannot be otherwise. Because it works with the divine principle. But we see some disorder happening everywhere. Then what is it? And it is something very closely connected with human life. Because the nature is the extended form of the individual. The person and the world are interrelated. So the existence is nothing but the individual, something which is more closely connected. Nature is our mother, and she is mother to all, and she is nourishing life on earth. And of course, man is the noblest, dearest son of Mother Nature. And when we look into nature, we can see the great love of the nature. And the animals are living here, plants are, vegetables are here, and the subtle small beings are there. So all are nourished by Mother Nature. For example, when an animal is born, the nature is immediately giving strength
to this animal. It can survive by itself. It did not wait for many long years. And the nature is giving the energy, the protection, the happiness, everything. And it is seeing that they can live happily on earth. But in the case of human beings, things are a little bit different. Because human beings are the highest among all creation. And when a child is born to a mother, the parents have to see that the child is protected, he is nourished. It is not the nature directly doing, but a higher responsibility is vested on the parents. And it takes many years that the child is able to survive by himself or herself. It is a longer process. It is a slow process. We can see that among animals, because they are born in the nature, they are living in the nature, and they are exploring the nature, they are happy. Of course, there is no school, there is no college, there is no university, there is no government, nothing. But they are living in the nature. But for humanity, for human beings, it is different. Because we are born in a family, and we are brought up in a family, and we go to the schools, and we are educated, and we have this social system, the government is there, and many, many things are involved. And so, but though we are having all these higher comforts in life, basically, human life is not very, very much different from the life of the animals. Because what the animals are doing? Because they are living according to the birth tendencies. When hungry, they want to eat. When they are tired, they want to sleep. And they live in fear. Fear psychosis in them when the danger comes. And also, they are easily moving into, when the sexual impulse comes, they move into sex. So sex, fear, sleep, and food. These are the four major aspects. Man is knowledge among creation. And this nobility is yet to be realized in human life. And this nobility is something very high. Because at the human plane we can see it is a miraculous formation of nature. Great capabilities are provided to human life, because the capacity of the human mind, the capacity of the human brain, and the human heart, and we are not exploring this greatness of humanity, of abilities of human life. But instead, we are in a way, we are going everywhere, not finding what is the aim of human life. Because human life is purposeful. A higher purpose is involved. And we are not recognizing this higher purpose of human life. Our birth is purposeful. Our life is purposeful. And the river is moving with a purpose, and the sun is rising with a purpose, and Sritava has come here with a purpose, and the purpose is very, very clear: to transmit the higher principle. And we have come here with a purpose. to listen to Shrita Dada, to meet him. So there is a purpose, and this purpose is not just our wish. No, this purpose is a divine design. It is a divine wish, divine will. And to understand this higher purpose or the divine will involved in our life is what we say wisdom. And this wisdom we are forgetting. We are not finding this wisdom in our life, because we are finding everything, definitely, there is no doubt about that. But we are not finding the wisdom. So what is the higher purpose of human life? What is the purpose of my birth? And where I am going? And where should I go? What is the destination? What is the real meaning of my life? So has death. They are nothing but illusions. But of course, we are dying, and we are dying to be born again. And when we are born, we are growing. The body is growing, and the newborn child is becoming an adult, moving into youthhood, and after many years, he is becoming old, and many diseases are coming. One day, dying. But not dying, actually, he is coming again. So this is repeating. It is like a cyclic movement is going on. And every time we are searching for happiness, we are searching for peace, we are searching for harmony, and we are searching for a good, higher social life. But this search is not fulfilled. And since this search for happiness and satisfaction was not fulfilled, we are again coming here, a new birth. So, but this is repeating, and we can never escape from this. The sorrow, the pain, the sufferings, the death, everything, it is coming, going, coming, going. But this is not the actual meaning of life. So human life can transcend this, from this vicious circle of births and deaths. And higher evolution is possible in human life. And a highly evolved consciousness can be possible in human life. And a very beautiful social life is possible on earth. But we are not finding means for that. And we are not recognizing the means for that. And now we have to think very deeply about this. What is this life? Now let us consider a very high and deep phenomenon, what we call the creation. And before creation, what existed? The great void. And this shunya, the shunya, that is the great void, is the primordial truth of creation. And that great void existed for millions of years. There is nothing to see, there is nothing to see, there is nothing to manifest, there is no movement, timeless, spaceless, it is only the void. And thereafter, an impulse, the first impulse, the first wish, what we call the primordial will, wish. So something has happened, some movement has happened in this void. And from that movement, a great aspiration, that a great realization, and that divine void could see, and earth is a place for life. And it is also a place of evolution. Because as per the creative design, as per the divine will, something quite amazing is happening here. Because there was a love, there was no life millions of years back. We know it. Science has said it. Now life born and life is progressing from the lower stage into the higher stage, and thereafter we can see the birth of human beings. And what is the speciality of human life in the context of evolution of life on earth? So the inert object has turned into life being, and mind has developed in the living beings. So human means it is the mental being. So mind evolved, and this growth of mental faculty is the speciality of human being. So it is a higher stage of evolution. Mind, human intelligence. And this growth, this evolution is not completed with mind. Because we know when the first race of human beings born on earth, they were living in just, they lived like animals, killing, eating, fighting, the fear psychosis. There was no house to live. They lived in caves and trees. The primordial races of human beings lived on earth. No culture, no family. But gradually, because of this higher faculty of mind, and this time is very special, because this is the time for the next evolution of human beings. So the mental being, the mental person, has to become the conscious being. And a consciousness, a higher consciousness, has to be born at the human plane. Because human mind is a limitation. And it is a limitation because we know our knowledge is limited, our energy is limited, our life is limited, our enjoyment is limited, everything is limited here. But the real scope of human life is unlimited, because we are unlimited. Our happiness is not limited. Our happiness is unlimited. Our knowledge is unlimited. Our ability is unlimited. But it is not yet happened. We are still living with limitation of human mind, because we can only live 60 years, after that or 70 years, after that we have to die. Limitation. And now the time is asking to transcend this limitation, to move into the higher areas of enjoyment, bliss, happiness. For that, the mental being has to become the conscious being, being of consciousness. The next higher evolution of human life, consciousness. Because consciousness is unlimited. It is not like limited human mind. It is unlimited. It is its knowledge, its happiness, its glory, its power, everything is unlimited. It is deathless, because it is never born. Since it is never born, it will never die. But this consciousness has to happen to us. Hence we can see that the future is great, if we recognize it, and if we prepare for that. Our aspiration of many lives can be fulfilled now. Our search for the real happiness, satisfaction, love, that can be fulfilled now, if we prepare for that. Because everything can be divinized. All aspects of human life on earth can be divinized. It is possible, because the time is ripened for that. But we are not ripened mentally. That is why the nature is demanding this now. More diseases, more unsatisfaction, more fighting, unsatisfaction in the family life, in our workplace. In many aspects of life, we face this problem, but it is also a blessing. Because unless we are in trouble, we will not look, we will not think, because we will sleep. Now the great time is giving the signal. See, now something great can happen on earth in your life. Get up, see it, prepare for that. But we are again sleeping. So the heat comes, the shake, the mother is shaking. No, even if the child is not getting the pinching. Like that, the mother existence is using all its tools to awaken humanity. So if we recognize this, we will pray to the nature, oh, how merciful you are. Because today we have everything. Because we have education, we have technology, scientifically, humanity, we have developed so much, all the comforts we have, and still we are not fully happy. Still in our family, we are not happy. In our workplace, we are not happy. And personally also, many things, we don't have peace. Why? What is the reason? Now what is wrong with us? What is lagging to us? And by having what we can have more peaceful, more in peaceful. What is lacking here? We have to think about this. And a child is born from the womb of the mother, from the love of the mother. And this child is growing in the society. After some time, some years, we can see he is moving, she is moving in some other, in the wrong path. We cannot give him the right aspiration in life, right aim in his life, in her life. And we see the child is later is suffering for many reasons. So the society cannot or is not able to show the right path to the younger generation already given to us. It is always available, but we are not able to understand it. For example, in the ancient times, the family of rishis, the tradition of rishis, were bringing this knowledge to earth, this higher knowledge required to fulfill human life on earth. And later we can see great beings coming to earth, bringing this knowledge to earth, to humanity. But so far humanity is not able to recognize the wisdom of that. But now it is possible. So that is the great benediction now we are having, because humanity can now receive, understand, manifest, realize this truth now. Because human mind have been growing. So only when it is grown, this can find understanding. Because a person who is living with a very low consciousness, awareness, cannot understand something high. It's natural. And now, because many millions are practicing yoga all around the globe, many are practicing meditation, and many groups are doing prayers, many spiritual practices, religious practices, everybody is doing. But it is also not enough now. Because we are doing, but we are not really understanding what does it mean. Because we are doing for something very limited. Because human mind is very limited. And we are doing it with some limited purpose. Somebody is doing yoga. Why you are doing yoga? I have some stomach problem. I am doing yoga for healing it. Somebody said that I am a channel of divine energy. And what you are doing with this energy, I am healing people because somebody is having a headache and my purpose is to heal this headache. So our purpose is limited. We are doing meditation. Why you are meditating? I want peace. So I am meditating. So purpose is, again, this is limited. So we are not understanding what can be the higher aim. So unless we recognize, we realize this higher aim, that will not happen. Meditation, we do meditation for 25 years, and what happened? Once we recognize this higher divine purpose of life, everything moves into a new dimension. The yoga, the meditation, the mantra japa, everything, our prayers, everything has got a new dimension. And for example, the yoga. So human beings are growing from the lower stage into the higher stage. Maybe from the animal past into the divine future. Maybe from the limited consciousness into the supreme awareness. We are growing. And for this growth, the body has some role. Our energy, life energy has got some role. Our mind has got some role. And culturing, culturing of body. So what is the purpose of yoga? Yoga intends culturing of our body. Because now this body is living with so much grossness. That impurities, because this body cannot hold the consciousness now. A culturing at the body level is inevitable. So yoga is the right way to culture the body, to purify the cells. And what is the purpose of pranayama? Pranayama is working with the energy body, because normally our energies are going away through the senses. Every way we are drained. So pranayama is reabsorbing this energy and moving it to the higher place. So if pranayama is rightly used, there is no wastage of energy. But we are more connected with the divine energy and we are always energetic. So this is how we are culturing the pranic body, the vital body. And the meditation, it is working with the mind. It cultures the mind, purifies the mind, it develops the mind. Like that, mind become more sharp, subtle. Recognize this great possibility, the great future, and prepare for this great journey, because now it is utmost important to us. And if we understand this aspect rightly, we can change the whole earth, we can change the social system, we can change the family life. Because we can really bring the happiness everywhere. And the great sharing of love, the great beauty, the great melody of divinity, we can have on earth this possibility. The time is very special. The world is moving through a great process of transformation, and this is a transitional period, and changes are taking place at all levels of life, and nobody can get away from this process of total transformation, and we have to prepare for the future, and we have to move with the course of the time that is very actively working for these larger changes. And in this situation, if we wakefully deal the situation, great hope is existing to human life. And it envelops all aspects of human life on earth. The personal life, the family, the society, the nation, and of course the whole earth. And a divinization at all levels are now possible. The rishis, transmitted the highest noble values of life to humanity. And it is universal in nature. And it transcends all limitations, whether racial or climatic or geographical. It can transcend, and it is transcending, because truth knows no boundary. It is beyond all boundaries, and its characteristic is universal, and an universal appeal is there in it, and universal significance is involved in it. And when we work with it, the higher principles, we see a great process of growth and evolution is taking place, because it is living with the principle which are carrying the truth at all levels. So it is connected with the truth. And now when we think about the contributions of such great rishis, the values of truth, and we say that it is universal, it is equally available and applicable to the whole humanity. Whether it is East or West does not matter. And since these principles are universal, human life can be motivated by that. For example, a human being is born and he is growing in life as a child, and what is the principle that a life of a child is based, and how a child can be brought up in the right way, and what are the physical, mental and energy level contributions that we can give to nourish the growth of the individual. So principles that is connected with the human life in the beginning. And what is the life of a householder? What is the family dharma? So how a man and woman should live in a family? And what spirit or energy is holding them together? And as a social being, what is our connection with society in the Vedic system? The span of life is divided into different stages. And the first two are the Brahmacharya Dharma and the Garhastha Dharma. And the Brahmacharya Dharma is the period of studentship, the childhood. And this is the period very important in human life. So we are becoming ourselves in this period, because our mental conditions, our physical health, our aspirations, our knowledge, everything has been programmed during this period of childhood. And our mental feeling, the psychological development is taking place during the childhood. Hence, in human life, most important period is childhood, which is known as Brahmacharya, the period of Brahmacharya. And education is most important, because through education only we are able to develop the human being. And the question arises, what sort of education is appropriate for the child? And we can see that the education that today we are giving to the child is not enough, because it is only partial. It is divisive, because not having the integral approach about life. When a student completes his education, he should be able to look his life as a total. It is not only a means to live, but a way of life. It is not just for job, but to fulfill the life. So education should make the child capable of living a life in satisfaction, in happiness, to fulfill his life. And today we can see that education is not serving this higher purpose. Because the universe is established and moves in two principles. The basic principle is changeless, the eternal principle. In the Vedic period, there is an education system which is known as the Gurukula system of education. And this Gurukula system of education practiced this holistic way of education, in which both aspect of knowledge, that is the permanent aspect of knowledge and the transient nature of knowledge, transient knowledge, both combined together to develop the integral human being through the system of education. And after this process of education, when the studentship is completed, we can see an holistic man is being is coming out from the schools, from the colleges, from the Gurukula. And this being has got the correct perception about life. When he enters into the family life, he is having the correct maturity, understanding, and an aspect of love which is unconditional. Like there is an inner development and know what is life, what is the family life. So with this holistic development and knowledge, when he enters into family life, this family life becomes something higher, something higher, something divine. And such a persons who are educated through this Gurukula system is coming to rule the country like great kings. And now they are not just human kings, rulers, but they are holding higher knowledge. And when this higher knowledge is there in a human mind, they get inspiration, what we say, intuition. So intuition is not logic. Intuition is a connection with the nature, with the existence. Because existence is in a movement. Nature is moving. It is a flow. And in course of time, it is bringing more and more aspect of truth to earth. So a clear human mind can perceive what is happening in the course of time. So what is true, what is just now, may not be the same tomorrow. Everything is changing here. So the human mind should be able to understand, perceive these higher truths in him, and then to mold the life on earth with this higher understanding. And if human mind is not able to be connected with higher knowledge and try to make human life better on earth, it will not happen. Because everything is interdependent. So such higher kings ruled, they have this higher perspiration. Vedic knowledge is integral in nature. It never denied life. And it never denied the spirit. And we can see a beautiful combination of spirit and life in the Vedic wisdom. And the rishis lived the life. They never denied it. And they enjoyed the spirit. And they asked human beings to live the same life of beauty and joy. And many times when we think about spirituality, religion, etc., a divisive attitude arises in our mind. We say, God is against the world and world is against God. Spirituality and materialism go in different directions, like parallel lines, never it can be. But it is not moving in different directions. It is always moving together. It is one reality. Because spirituality means inner growth, inner development. It is expansion of our inner being. And life means the manifestation of this inner divinity, inner knowledge. And it always moves together. If we only think about spirituality and deny life, it is only partial. It is not the real life. And if when we say only about material things and deny the spirit, it is also partial. When life becomes partial, it will not give us the satisfaction. That is why what we see in the world, spiritual people are not satisfied because they deny the life. And those who are so much materialistic, they are not happy because they deny the spirit. So we have to join both consciousness, spirit and the life together. It should always move together, grow together and manifest together. And this is the beauty of the knowledge given by the rishis. And their contribution is so scientific. And science and religion and spirit, everything moves together. Because what is science? Science is an inquiry of the truth. And scientists are trying to find the material truths. The divinity is already within us. But we have to find it, to claim it. Today, our life is not developed to be connected with this inner divinity. Because why? Because now this life is not the life. Actually, it is not the real life. Because we have a body, mind, and we are living. And this living only is only in the external levels only. The deeper aspect of the life is not yet known to us. We know the mind, but not the consciousness. The consciousness is deeper, it is higher. Mind is only a very limited reflection of the consciousness. But we are only working with the mind, it is external. So what are the deeper aspects of our life, what are the deeper aspects of our mind, it is yet to be known to us. So we have to awaken this inner truth which is sleeping in us. And the health is a great workshop. And we are incarnated here to do the job. And the divine is the great employer. And when we incarnated here on earth, we have forgotten it. And we are deluded here. Because we are deluded in many things. Because we have forgotten from where we have come. And who sent us to here? And what is the work to be done here? And after completing the work, to where we should go? We have forgotten all these things. And then what happened? The birth, the death, the disease, the pain, the suffering, the sorrow, the fighting, the exploitation, all the mess. And we made the whole earth like this. And this is what we got unfortunately. The great gift, we forgot it. But now we have to remember it. Why we are here? What is the purpose of our birth? What is the purpose of our life here? And from where we have come, and after completing our work here, where we should go? We should remember this. And if we are able to remember this, our life will not be the same. Immediately our life changes. Our attitude changes. Our aspiration changes. The life, now what we have may not be enough. Because this is not the real life. And this life is not leading us to something permanent, something high, something divine, something which is not perishable. Because whatever we have today, tomorrow is going to vanish. This body will go, the wealth will go. And all the things that we are thinking, give us happiness, not be available to us tomorrow, because one day we have to go from this body, from earth. But we are not thinking about these things, the deeper aspect of life. What is the real meaning of life? So what after all I want to gain out of this life, deeper aspect of life. But now we have to think about the deeper aspect of life, the higher aspect of life, the permanent aspect of life, the blissful aspect of life. We have to think, we have to consider. Let us think about the very practical aspect of this. Because now we have to come back to the body, to be connected with the ground, to be ground-oriented. So we see the realities. We are focusing our mind to the situations in which today we are living. And we see the turbulence, the problems, the difficulties, that is growing everywhere, aggravating everywhere. And what first should be done? Because before this higher knowledge, higher truth, being integrated to human life, before to that, we have to make the ground ready for that. To pacify earth, pacify the aggravated energies working in the nature, pacify human minds. We have to bring peace first. Then only the higher things can be given. First peace, then the journey. So now, we are planning here for that. Great prayer for peace. To bring peace to earth, to human mind, all aspects of life on earth, we have to work for that. And these prayers are a collective prayer, because we are all joining in this higher process. And we are blessed with the higher principles, higher truths, higher instruments, higher methods transmitted by your rishis, the Vedic masters. For example, Sri Rudra Japa, Sri Rudra Archana, these are some process formulas to bring peace to earth, to bring peace to human mind. So we all together working with these higher principles to bring peace to earth first. And for the last 4 years, in our ashram in Kerala, we are doing regular Vedic rituals, Sri Rudra Japa, and two opposite forces are actively working on the earth plane, the positive forces and the negative forces. And the order of earth is maintained by the balancing of these forces, the positive forces. And when the negative forces exceed, the balance, the order is disturbed. And today we can see this imbalance, because the negative forces have become more powerful on earth. And the great and the imbalance is occurring in all aspects of our life. Disorder in our personal life, disorder in our families, disorder everywhere we see. And according to the Vedic tradition, whenever such disorder evolved on earth, they do great yagas and yajnas. And yagas and yajnas are a collective activity wherein the great sadhagas, the great tapasins, who hold the high energy and consciousness, they come together and they use the divine Vedic mantras to connect with the higher plane, to bring the energy, to bring balance. Likewise, such yagas and yajnas had been used very effectively to bring order back, bring the balance in life. And now, again, something of such kind is absolutely necessary to bring balance back to earth in human life. And such yagas and yajnas can be very positively used for the elevation of human life on earth. balancing as well as elevation. And in our system, we are doing such yagas and yajnas for bringing this peace, harmony.
His name Rudra is from the Vedas. And it denotes the one of the principal aspect of the divine force. And the divine force on the earth plane work with different faces. For example, Rudra is one principal facet of the divine force. And this name is a natural. This prayer we do in 2-3 steps. The first step is Rudra, Sri Rudra chanting. That is, we are chanting the mantra. Then, because it is, you are not familiar with this mantra, so you can just listen this mantra, so that this energy can move deep into our subtle levels, and it can create the right atmosphere inside. So an attentive listening is enough at the first stage. Sri Rudra mantras are chanted. And in the next stage, we also participate in this process by archana.